¡Recuperarse! ¡Soldados, recuperen! ¡Para San Antonio!
Struck, America seemed to become a land of migrants. A trickling out west became a flood, desperately seeking opportunity. Some took all they had and tried to make a start in the newly liberated land of Mexico. Two of Missouri's own, Stephen F. Austin and Green DeWitt, promised to lead the way to desperate immigrants. But why was Mexico so willing to accept? Well, much of that has to do with the depopulation of Texas following the Battle of Medina.
On August the 18th of 1813, the biggest, bloodiest battle ever in Texas occurred 20 miles south of San Antonio by a community called Lozoya. The Republican Army of the North consisted of about 1,400 men, and that included about 900 Tejanos, 300 American volunteers, and perhaps as many as 200 Lipan and Cuchara Indians. Spain was still a superpower, so they sent up an army under Joaquin de Arredondo, who was later called the Butcher, El Carnicero. They were totally defeated at the Battle of Medina. Over 900 bodies were left out there on the battlefield for over 9 years. 100 more were executed as they fled towards Louisiana, and another 327 were executed in San Antonio. By the time it was over, one-third of the Tejano community was dead, one-third would flee to Louisiana, and then the remaining third would live in terror.
And so for Mexico, when it became independent, they realized that there's a really big power imbalance there that they've got to do something about. And so they come up with this impresario system, which is essentially, an impresario is essentially a land agent who would be given permission to bring in a certain number of American families. And they had a quota, basically. Stephen F. Austin's original contract as an impresario was for 300 families. Green DeWitt's original contract was for about 400 families. And the idea was that you had about 6 years to settle 300 or 400 families. And what you could offer these families was land. So Mexico becomes independent in 1821 to try to establish a government, and they establish a monarchy. And that doesn't last, that doesn't go very well. And so they decide, okay, monarchy didn't work. We're going to go the opposite direction and establish a federal republic. And this was a very big deal for the Texans, for the Tejanos, the Mexicans who are native to Texas, and the new impresarios who were coming in, who wanted to come into Texas. When they started debating all of this stuff in Mexico City with the federal constitution that was being written, everything about colonization in Texas would be decided. Stephen F. Austin himself went down to Mexico City to lobby on behalf of allowing the Anglo-Americans in. The Tejanos had sent down a man named Erasmo Seguin, who was from one of the more politically connected families in San Antonio. And for the Texans, the real big question was, are you going to allow American immigration in, and are you going to allow slavery in? What Stephen F. Austin could sell, and then later Green DeWitt could sell to the colonists, was cheap land. It was really good for cotton farming.
It was in the Mexican capital of the territory of Tejas, San Antonio de Bejar, that Rose first met Green DeWitt on April 17, 1825. After a wait of more than 3 years, DeWitt had finally received his impresario contract to the westernmost colony in Tejas. Naming his planned capital city after the governor of Coahuila y Tejas, Rafael Gonzalez, DeWitt lost little time preparing for his new arrivals.
You can tell your readers this one thing. Tell them to come to Gonzalez, Texas. Success is guaranteed. Access to rivers and roads. The land is rich and 10 times cheaper than it is in the United States. Success seems certain.
Anything else?
Well, you must be of good moral character, and you must convert to Roman Catholicism, but have you seen my glasses?
The ones on your forehead?
Oh, sorry, I get distracted. Excuse me, I must tell my wife, Sarah, the good news.
DeWitt, however, found himself plagued with difficulties. One was over land.
I don't understand it. On my way back to Gonzales, I ran across 40 families that were living on my land. On my land. Another impresario, Martin De Leon, claims that it's his.
Por favor, esta es mi tierra. Yo he vivido y criado en esta zona desde 1799. Pero debemos dejar que los funcionarios decidan. Pero no me preocupo. Esta es mi tierra.
I also spoke with the secretary to the Leones, Plácido Benavides.
Dos toros, uno viejo y uno nuevo. Ellos están luchando por pesos dentro de la manada. Es todo lo que es, dos toros de cabezas fuertes.
When the government did rule in the matter, it ruled in favor of Martín de León.
The Tonks. That rose is the reason why I cannot get the colonists I need. The Indians are scaring my colonists away. Until we can defend ourselves against the Indians, I fear we cannot get the security that we need. I petitioned the government. They sent some soldiers, but they left. I feel that we need something more permanent. I guess we have to wait on the government.
¿Por qué estoy asistiendo a los inmigrantes? Rosario, todo está en la Constitución 1824. La más gente que tenemos, más pronto podemos llegar a ser un estado nuestro. Cuanto antes nos convertimos en un estado mexicano independiente, más pronto podemos asegurar nuestros derechos en lo económico, social, políticamente más, tenemos la mejor para todo el mundo.
So the Tejanos in San Antonio are the real power brokers for Texas, and they're the ones who are representing the Anglo colonies in their debates with the state government in Saltillo, in Coahuila, and in all the debates in Mexico City. And the Tejanos are deeply aware of both state level and national politics at all levels. The Tejanos are deeply committed Federalists as a general rule. For the most part, you would think of the Tejanos as Federalists, which we would say more like states' rights, essentially. What they wanted was Texas to have the authority to decide many of its own issues for itself. And so in all of these debates at the national level about centralism, federalism, the Tejanos overwhelmingly came down on the Federalist side of things.
In 1831, they finally got their cannon, a small gun that had been spiked. It was good for making a loud noise, which kept the natives at bay. DeWitt had fallen short of his mandated quota for families, but the Mexican government recognized those he had brought in. It seemed like things were working out until...
There's a growing demand in Texas after 1830, Texas needs to separate itself from Coahuila. Having been joined in 1824, it was an uneasy marriage, if you will. It was a forced marriage. There is a growing fear among the Coahuilenses that what's happening in Texas is not only unlawful and not just disloyal, but in a way very dangerous to the continued existence of Texas as part of Mexico. They see the danger of a complete break.
Well, I'm not too crazy about this new law. Me and my wife,
Susanna,
we arrived here about 6 months back with 54 others, and well, we got ourselves some good land, Let's just say, I'm glad we got here when we did.
Now, Almiron, Mr. DeWitt and Austin got some good exemptions. Everything's going to be fine.
All right, Susanna. Everything's going to be fine. Everything's going to be just all right.
Explicarme. Esto es como voy a explicar. Mira, solo soy solo un dedo, pero tenía otros de ser un puño. Debo mantenerlos unidos, todo debe estar ligado.
Forgive me if I have to leave suddenly.
Of course.
I'm supporting the Federalists in trying to acquire more land. Many people have left for security. But I'm confident that the Federalists will succeed and Texas will again be successful. Excuse me.
Yo llevaba un vestido como este hace 22 años. Solo tenía 13 años. Santa Ana, solo un teniente. Ugartechea, un cadete. General Joaquín de Arredondo y su tormenta devastaron a Texas. En el nombre del orden que decimó a Texas, uno de cada 10 hombres como mi padre fueron masacrados. Que me perdonen, pero solo en el clic de las botas escucho una tempestad creciente.
Earlier today, a group of 12 colonials led by George Washington Davis arrested 5 Mexican soldados. Why were they arrested?
They were up to no good. In Zolmite's store, they stole something. Tried to stop them, but they went over and hit someone on the head with a rifle.
But weren't they on the other side of the river?
No, you heard wrong. One ran. We're gonna take the prisoners to Goliad.
Well, the important thing, I suppose, is the cannon is still safe.
These new Texans, if you will, these new Mexicans, are interpreting things. I've come to believe in a way that harkens back to the American Revolution. So they see the arrival of Mexican troops in Texas just like the British troops arrive in Boston. In other words, they're equating the actions of the Mexican government with the actions of the British imperial government. And so they actually see the Mexican government as a foreign government attempting to impose its will on a colonial people. So they see themselves as patriots in the colonial mold, and Mexico City as the imperial power in the British mold.
Rosario, sin cambio, no hay problemas. Nada más para informar de una disputa.
Coronel.
¿Cómo te atreves a tener miedo a mis hombres?
¿Hombres? ¿Quieren decir que usted y sus 80 vaqueros de salir a jugar?
¿A jugar? Íbamos a luchar por nuestro gobierno. Nuestro verdadero gobierno bajo nuestra verdadera constitución.
Jefe Seguín, ¿qué se olvide? Tenemos un verdadero gobierno debajo de Santana.
Tú estás ocupado en un perro faldero y se puede ver su libertad escapando.
¡Le quitan! ¡Ándale! Otra vez con los norteamericanos, menores de Travis. Y ahora, los bejareños. Mira, las cosas se están volviendo muy tensas. Si todo el mundo acaba de calmarse y obedece la ley, todo estaría bien.
Pero, ¿hay algo de cierto acerca de por qué usted quiere tomar el cañón de González?
As the civil war in Mexico breaks out between centralists and federalists, the Tejanos are firmly on the side of the federalists and invariably are on that particular side in the Texas Revolution.
In an innocent action, Colonel Ugartechea hit the hornet's nest. He sent soldiers to retrieve the cannon at González. With that cannon received, they were to march on to Victoria and appropriate their defense as well. The one thing that stopped them was a stand at González.
When the Mexican government says, things are getting dangerous, you're shooting at us, we need to collect the heavy artillery and bring it back to San Antonio because we need to be, the Mexican government doesn't try to collect all arms, it doesn't try to collect small arms, it's just going out after the heavy artillery when it arrives in González, and the people of González says, no, you can't have it. We need this for our self-defense, so you're going to have to come and take it. When they arrive, what they find is resistance.
They weren't fighting for or pushing for Texas independence from Mexico. They were fighting for the same thing that people in Zacatecas were fighting for, people in the Yucatan were fighting for, which was to restore the Constitution of 1824, and therefore to restore the rights and powers of the individual states to decide their own affairs within the Mexican nation.
Mira, me dijeron que la ciudad fue casi abandonada. Entonces me dijeron que había más de 200 colonos dispuestos a luchar. Todo lo que realmente sé es que estos 18 chicos me dicen que no van a liberar el cañón. A mí hasta que habla con su alcalde Andrés Pontón.
¿Te dijeron cuándo podría llegar?
Mañana en algún momento de la tarde. Hasta entonces vamos a esperar el nuestro campamento. Escucha, yo no estoy aquí para causar problemas. Estoy aquí solo por el cañón.
The only thing I couldn't tell Lieutenant Castañeda was that the 18 guys stopping the army were the only people left in the town. If reinforcements don't arrive, all will be lost.
Look, that cannon was given to us in 1831. After all that we've endured, all the gains that we scratched from the soil, that cannon was our only defense. That cannon's not only our defense, it's the key. And that cannon ain't going anywhere.
To find out what's on the soldiers' minds, I went to interview Lieutenant Castañeda.
Me dijeron que Pontón estaría aquí y no lo es. Pensé que esto sería fácil y no lo es. Estoy moviendo de campamento porque estoy en un terreno que pertenecía a Green DeWitt. No cañón, pero también me ordenaron no iniciar una pelea. Habla conmigo mañana.
In the face of the aggression before us earlier today, one group decided to take action. I cannot write where we are. But the important thing is that it is safe.
Hey, we gotta get going. They can't see us out here.
It's morning and the issue with the cannon is still unresolved. Settlers are flooding the colonial side, but I'm starting the day with Castañeda and his men to see what might happen today. Lieutenant Castañeda, buenos días. ¿Qué crees que podría pasar hoy?
Hoy en día más están llegando cada momento. Hoy voy a ir a un lugar para que pueda tener una idea de lo que está pasando en González. Mis órdenes son para obtener el cañón, pero también me dijeron para entrar la confrontación.
George Washington Davis, I'm here to...
Look! They're on the move! Trying to cross the river! They think it's gonna be McClovia all over again! We need to get that cannon!
After a night filled with activity, a stillness surrounded the morning. Last night, the militia armed with the cannon had crossed the river. Rifle shots were exchanged with the soldados, and one colonial may have been wounded, but due to the fog, an unsteady peace prevailed. Castañeda met with John Henry Moore to discuss the fight, but little is known what was said. Now that the fog lifted, let's go and join Rose as she talks with Castañeda.
¿Qué pasó en la reunión que tuvo con John Moore anoche?
¿Qué pasó? ¿Qué sucedió? Dijo que era una federalista y no renunciara a los cañones. Le dije, yo también una federalista, pero se necesitaba para recuperar el cañón. Le dijo, a unirse a su ejército y él me haría un oficial. Le dije que renunciara a los cañones y todos serán perdonados. Y él podría trabajar con el gobierno aquí en Texas.
¿Perdonado?
Sí, pero esto no podía hacer lo que le pedí, así como no podía rebelarse y unirse a su lado lo que le pedía.
Entonces, ¿qué va a pasar ahora?
Lo que suceda. Bueno, la niebla está despedazo. ¡Recuperarse! ¡Soldados, recuperen! ¡Para San Antonio!
Plácido Benavides and some of his ranchers arrived to train the collected troops placed under Stephen F. Austin. Some of the troops were dispatched to defend Victoria. The rest of the Federalist Army, however, is preparing to march on to San Antonio to fight for and secure our rights and freedoms promised under the Constitution of 1824.
It's just a dress. Just a dress. My mother, Sarah, said it's for my father's dream. For the dreams of so many. And that it needed to be white so that all could see. It's not a surrender. It's a challenge. To come and take it, and for our rights, our constitutional rights. And if the Constitution of 1824 is to live or die, it'll be decided here and now in Texas. So that's why we had to use my wedding dress. So please excuse me. I need to finish this so I can take it to the troops tomorrow before they leave.
Come on, Susanna.
I'm coming.
Shh, it's okay.
You know it takes me longer when I'm carrying Angelina Elizabeth.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, my little bug.
Amaral, Susanna, excuse me. Are you joining the army going to San Antonio?
You bet. I'm going to make sure that myself, my wife Susanna, and my baby Angelina, we all have a bright future ahead of us.
And Susanna, what do you think when you take a look at the Gonzales flag they mounted on the cannon?
It reminds me that we're living in new times, exciting times. That flag marks a birth, the birth of a revolution.
And of course, they're not going to put up with it. And just as in the case of the British colonies, where they go from rebellion and no, we want our rights, and no, we want to continue having our legislatures, and no, we want to preserve that relationship that of equals, Texans essentially go down the same path, and by March of 1836 are more than happy to declare their independence because they've come to see Mexico as a foreign power trying to impose its will on Texas. It's incumbent on us to understand that all of this is happening in part because Tejanos themselves, and particularly Tejano elite families themselves, are siding, by and large, with those who are making the decisions to rebel. So making the Tejanos making common cause with the Texans convince the Texans that they're right.